When I was a student, she was an established feminist. She was the one who first began the rigorous workshop. She and Maria Mies, they began the rigorous workshop on concept of paid and unpaid work, productive and unproductive work, non-recognition of women work, way back in 1978, Lonavala workshop by Dalikas Institute of Political Economy. Thank you. Facilitating the administrative task. Besides, I would like to thank to our partners who have rendered generous help to make this event a success. Friedrich, Ebert, Stiftung, UNI-APRO, International Center for Development and Decent Work, German Academic Exchange, Federal Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development, Excellence Center for Exchange and Development, Bharat Petroleum, Indian Oil Corporation of India, European Commission, Citizens' Rights Collective ActionAid, Citizens' Rights Collective ActionAid Association. Now we will proceed towards the plenary session, Macroeconomic Perspective on Paid and Unpaid Work of Women. And the chairperson is Dr. Uma Chakravarti. We welcome Dr. Uma Chakravarti on the dais. A democratic rights activist and an independent filmmaker. We welcome you, ma'am.
I think that this 10 minutes is just too little for anyone to say anything useful. With me, I am going to first introduce the panel to you. Professor Ritu Dwan is a director and professor, Department of Economics, University of Mumbai. She's also Professor, Center for Women's Studies, located within the Department of Economics, University of Mumbai. Professor Christoph Scherer is Full Professor of Globalization and Politics, Executive Director of the International Center for Development and Decent Work at the University of Kassel, and a member of the Steering Committee of the Global Labour University. He's Chair of the Graduate School of Ecological Research and Development, and he directs two English language master's programs, MA Political Economy and Development and MA Labour Policies and Globalization. He has received the Excellency in Award, Teaching Award of the State of Hesia and the Excellence in Development Cooperation Award from the DAAD. He is an adjunct member of the graduate faculty, Rutgers University, New Brunswick. Dr. Meena Valadhan is a senior policy analyst. She's president of the Indian Association of Women's Studies. She was editor of IAWS newsletter. She's been associated with several grassroots networks working on land rights and livelihood issues. And Dr. Indira Hirwe, National Fellow of the ICSSR, is Director and Professor of Economics at Center for Development Alternatives. She's also associate at Levy Economics Institute, New York, and Conference President of ISLE for the year 2014. Can I invite everybody to come and take their places? I see only two people as yet. Where? Ritu and Indira. Indira Hirwe? Give everybody a clap. And I will not now, I'll just follow the sequence to save time. According to the schedule, I think it's Ritu who has to do the first presentation. And we'll follow the order. Ritu, then, who's next on the... It's Christoph, then Meera, and then Indira. Okay? All right. With no further ados, Ritu.
Sorry for this till the PPT comes on. Please don't count these 2 minutes which have gone in my 10 minutes. And I hope the very nice chairperson that you are, and you agree 10 minutes is not enough. So if it's a minute here and there, please
only a minute
forgive. How long that minute will be is very difficult. Delighted to be here and very, very happy that this issue is being taken up. It's not been given its seriousness, of course, for a very long time. We've had several conferences on this issue before. And there are many issues that debate, and I'm not going to talk about all of them in 10 minutes. It's really very difficult. But in this context, what I would like to do, first of all, of course, thank the organizers, Vibhuti and Nandita. I think a really marvelous job. And the number of people who are here and the quality of people who are here, I think that's really very, very important. Now, what I am going to do today is really a result of about almost 2 years of work, which totally me and Radha, who's here, have been totally involved in, and the kind of learnings we have from this. I'm not going to share the copy of the report. I'm going to share only the methodological fundamentals which we have learned, the concepts, and viewed within the broader context of something I very, very strongly believe in, and that patriarchy is a macroeconomic construct. It's not only, in quotes, only a social component. There's much more to it, and unless we recognize that aspect, I don't think we're really going to get into the essentials of this. Now, what I have done here is, of course, divided into three and sections, so broadly, and I'm not going to be reading out, obviously. A lot of stuff is there which is understood and which is also can be perceived in a teaching. But what I have done very, and I think this is very important, is the issue of singleness and how it's not only female-headed households, but being single in a labour market and how it impacts you in a very, very strong and a very different kind of a context. Now, of course, this is, we know, at a general level, the SDGs and what it says, and the three basic issues which for me are very important. How work is distributed, and here I'm not taking only women, because women, again, if you isolate them, then again it's like not seeing them in a particular economic or a societal context. So taking men and women together, the macroeconomic policies, and these are various which I've done and which we've done, and really wish, I think when we were working out these two or three questions, Subbalakshmi, I think many of you know her, was very much part of this. And I'm not going into the details, but I'm just telling you what we have done, and what I'm going to present is based on the issues of water, of energy, and of care seen in a very specific context, in which one did a lot of policy evaluations and gender budgeting, etc. And of course, through various tools of analysis, and that horrible word called case studies. You know, I think it's time we found, it's a different phrase for that. Now, there are, I think, about 20 or 30 learnings. I'm going to just focus on 5 or 6, which I feel are absolutely essential. One is that there is nothing like paid work to be seen in isolation or unpaid work. This volume, please turn on, Jessica. That squeak is very irritating. It's like chalk on the board. Not for me, but I think for the people. And this context of a work continuum. So it's like you don't know where the unpaid work ends and where the paid work starts. Are they two combined? It's not a linear. It's a very non-linear and multi-interactory kind of an aspect. And this context, I think, is something which we must really use, because when we are seeing unpaid, you have to see it in the broader context of all the kinds of work which women and also men do. So therefore, taking the various manifestations of, I think, the classic examples which come out from our earlier definitions which we used to use, that is work which has exchange value and work which has use value. The second is something, again, which we always talk about. One is recognizing unpaid work, reducing it, and redistributing it. And this question of redistribution, of course, some policy analysis comes into this, and some macroeconomic, that please do more of this and less of this, etc., in terms of investment and allocations.
but also the redistribution component is generally limited to within the household. And I think this time you took it out from within the household and the full responsibility within a family in quotes. I'm using the two words very separately, household and family. And within this, the fourth R which I'm adding is that of redefining work. That we have to, so redefining unpaid work, and in this I have broken up unpaid work, because generally seen unpaid work is equal to care, but I think that just reduces or reinforces the concept of a woman being a reproductive agent and not an economic agent or a maintenance agent, which is her primary role in society. So therefore the four R's and not the three R's, redefining, recognizing, reducing and redistributing, because you cannot do any of the others unless you redefine what is the concept of work. Now of course I found at various levels, I'm not going into the details, two sectors which I took up were women had employed the most, construction in urban and agriculture in rural, and the kind of responses which have come that at every single level, feminization of paid and unpaid work, including the concept of care, operates at every, whether it was Uttarakhand or Telangana or Hyderabad or Sholapur or whichever other areas which I worked on. The fourth is, we have what is called a care diamond, and this is what defines or what is supposed to impact women's work, which is absolutely correct. That is the market, the state, the voluntary sector and the household. And to this I'm adding a fifth component, and which is the concept of community and caste. I think these are just not taken up seriously in terms of impact on women's work continuum, and has to be integrated, because it's not only very patriarchally very strong, caste and community, but increasingly so in today's context, and that's something which is very, very worrying, because it impacts women's work at every single level in the context of the continuum. The fifth is what, when I was trying to evaluate, using of course our time use studies, and we are all very familiar with time use studies, I found that that was very important. And in addition to that, and not as an alternative in that sense of the term, but something which strengthens the analysis of how women use their time, we evolved a new method, and that is the time distribution, that on an average, within a week, whether it's rural sector or urban sector or whatever the sector is, that how is that work distributed? Because fundamentally work, I think at every level, men, women, children, at every level, if there is a multiplicity, what we call multitasking, it's not only a multiplicity, but it's also a simultaneity. At the same time, you're grazing cattle, you're cutting the grass, you're looking after the children, you're filling water. How are you going to capture that multiplicity is something which I was very, very concerned about. And this is something which operates particularly even in the urban sector, in the context of none of the provisions of construction workers which I was working on are provided, whether it's water or creche or any other kind of the many, many facilities which are guaranteed under the BAPWA. The sixth major learning is that what I find is that the number of women involved within a broader universe of 100 and the number of men involved in any particular activity or sub-activity is much, very different. And that is, a larger number of women within a universe, within say 100, the proportion of women within 100% involved in those activities is more than the number of men. And therefore we found it very necessary to try and capture this differential which exists, which is what I call the gender activity participation rate. And this is it is the intensity of work. Now just to give you one example, which is a very unusual example, but which we found universal in that sense of the term, is the safeguarding of crops and the safeguarding from animals. And we found that many more women than men within that universe of 100 did this work than men did. So your GAPR for women became much wider and much stronger than it did for men. This is also in care activities, particularly in childcare activities. Overall, if we see childcare, yes, men also participate. It's not that they don't, and therefore the demand for paternity leave, which many of us in our movements and our struggles and our organizations asked for, but also the fact that the number of activities under child care which women perform are less than what men perform. So therefore, these are than what women perform. So these are issues which are very specific, very important. Estimating the continuum, two more. One is the amount of time which women spend. And we found a huge variation. I mean, even in 3 minutes, okay? Even where the same activities are concerned and the sub-activities are concerned, that women express a wider range of time extending from, say, 5 minutes to 3 hours than men did. Now, just one example is that of eating. Now, we said how much time do you spend eating? So women, very often men said 20 minutes. Okay, that's the time it takes to eat a meal. For women, just eating a meal, not preparing, they said 5 minutes to 3 hours, and we could not understand why 5 minutes and why 3 hours and what is this entire range. And therefore, this range really becomes a fact that she eats when there is no other work or while doing some other work, or when she's eating, she can sit down and have a meal. That meal is interspersed by many kinds of other activities. So therefore, this issue of the min-max range is we found a very, very important methodological tool to add on to our knowledge of the work continuum. The eighth component is of course, the very, very strong impact of macroeconomic policies. And I'm not even going to the details. We know there's some amount of work which is some of us have done on this issue. But just to give you one or two examples, we have, of course, the famous gas scheme affair, which is something which we evaluated, and which is very nice conceptually, etc., that yes, women need gas, but for cooking and clean cooking energy. But there are three things. I mean, those who are working on gender budgeting, please be very, very careful when we talk about allocations, is because this scheme is not a gender scheme. It comes with the Ministry of Natural Gas. All right? So it should not be lumped. The money allocated to this should not be lumped as what is called a women-specific or a women-oriented scheme. Not at all. One is that. Secondly, by saying it is women-oriented, and you have these wonderful posters of these stars of the day, the political stars of the day, with one woman looking very gratefully at the gas which is being handed out to her, is the fact that that reinforces the fact that cooking is only women's job. All right? So that kind of an issue. Another scheme which we evaluated and which has many ramifications which we, I think, are not coming out really to the fore the way they should, and that is the DBK. And that is the direct benefit transfer or the deduction, to put it in a simple way, deduction in subsidies on kerosene. So once you are gas, you do not get kerosene. Kerosene becoming more and more expensive, and therefore you have a huge impact on women's health. Because the chulas, which still dominate 80 to 90% of women's cooking, gas is not easy to come by. The first cylinder may be easy, in the sense it may be given to you, but getting the second one, financing the second one, and getting the refilling of that on a mobile, in an SMS, which is not readable by women, 80% of whom in the rural areas are illiterate. Okay? Now, there are just another 2 minutes. Is a question which I really want to talk about, many illustrations, but what is I call unquantifiable and indefinable. And there are two examples only which I'm going to give. One is, of course, you know, as construction workers, one waits at nakas for work. That means you're standing there waiting for your labor power to be purchased. Okay? And naka is a typical labor contract. Now, if one calculates the time, we generally ask what is the waiting time at the naka. Okay? You can get zero waiting time, and therefore you say time is not being wasted. Alright? That is the interpretation. But this has a double-edged meaning to it. There is no waiting time at a naka for work. One, because you get work immediately, or because you know you're not going to get work. And therefore, you don't wait for more than 5 or 10 minutes and you're out. And this is particularly something that is the issue of aging. So the older workers, whether it is men or whether it is women. And this finding we found very reinforced by the current study we are doing with Nature on demonetization and impact on construction workers. The second one, which is endemic and systemic and increasing, so deeply and it internalized so strongly is that of sexual exploitation. Sexual exploitation of a woman worker is inbuilt into her work contract. Now, how do we calculate that half an hour? Is it unpaid work? Is it care work? Is it underpaid work? Is it paid work? I mean, these are issues, I think, which we really have to try and understand. And that's why I just call them unquantifiables. I'm just rushing through. Yeah. No, in the singleness, I'm just two aspects which I want to raise. There are many aspects which are coming in. And here I'm talking of women who enter the labor market single, not female-headed households. And therefore, within this, a whole lot of wage inequalities, division of labor, etc., etc. And the fact that in the current context of macroeconomic context of unemployment, you have what is called the emergence of half work. This is a term which I, you know, half widow, which I created when I was doing the Kashmir issue. And I find that same thing very operative, that women who are single get less work than men do. And of course, the issue of child labor, sexual harassment, etc. And the fact that this utter destitution of women and the desperation of these women, once they leave the house, the only accommodation they have is in their home, maybe of their brother, which is the novel, in which that rent in court is paid back in use value, and that is in the context of a paid and unpaid work, whether it is care work or whether it is any other kind of work. There's a lot more to say, but finally I just go back to the title and just say one phrase, that today's paid economy cannot survive unless there is an unpaid economy. Okay, that is what really keeps the economy growing, and that's something, that's the continuum, I think, of the essence of the integration which we really have to look at. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Here, especially by Professor Mandal, because I'm not really a gender specialist, a few years ago I brought out a book, a concept called gender knowledge, and I tried to apply that to the issue of policy communities, gender knowledge about women in agriculture. And what's the puzzle? The puzzle is that we have lots of policy papers that call for the empowerment of women, but when you look at it, on the ground, you will see rather little happens. And the question is, why? And I'll tell you here about these kind of calls, the United Nations, the Sustainable Development Goals, the FAO in Rome, and so on. They all call for this kind of policies. But when we look at the ground level, we see, and we just heard about it, it's the longest working hours, least access to resources, decision-making, meaning most vulnerable. And the policies that come out of the agricultural policy-making community are mostly, not all, but mostly geared towards mechanization, chemicalization, and commercialization especially. And if gender is considered, then it is only done in a rather partial way. I give three examples, but I think given the time, I will just perhaps go to one of those there, or two perhaps. And when we look at the issue of mechanization of agriculture, meaning, for example, the introduction of the tractor, a study has just come out on two African countries, and they have pointed out that women do most of the work, the hard work, but strangely enough, they are not really calling for mechanization for the use of tractors there. And why so? And then they did a major case study on that. And it is because of the interlocking, not just one factor, but the interlocking of these factors, that the women are expected to work hard, that's the value aspect of it, that they don't have the access to the resources, and that the decisions are made by men. And when it comes then actually to the introduction of the tractor, it is seen that the tractor is not helping the women's work, for women are used to do the work, but it is doing something else, so they are not really benefiting from that. another example, and that's an interesting example because here the empowerment of women is written on the policy and is driving the policy, and the idea is that women should start making use of traditional indigenous vegetables where they have the knowledge what to do with it, and they should commercialize it. That, and one, the policy is giving them support to commercialize that. And the case study has shown that once it is commercialized, the men are moving in. That, so they are taking over. And the other aspect that has been overlooked is that especially this one vegetable, which name I forgot, is extremely time consuming in preparation. And women have done that traditionally once in a while, but they are not willing, for good reasons, to do that all the time there. And that has been also overlooked in the design of the policy. So, how to deal with this puzzle? There is this kind of push for empowerment of women, but rather little comes to the ground. And one approach, theoretical approach, has been under this title of gender knowledge and has been developed by the professor Irene Dölling from Potsdam University. She is a very shy person. I couldn't find any picture of her on the internet. But from Sünder Andresen, who has a similar function in practice. And that's, I think, is how one can make a better sense of this puzzle I was mentioning. And this concept was applied first concerning the gender mainstreaming of the European Union in public enterprises there. So what does it mean? Well, it has the aspect of the implicit and explicit beliefs about the sexes, the normative positions on the appropriateness of the relationship between the sexes, how one should relate to each other, and also very interesting, what one sees as evidence for that, you know, that in, one sees that, women are doing the care work, therefore they are naturally born for care work. That is then the evidence that many people take. Now one can make use of that concept on two levels, on a micro level and on a macro level. On a micro level, it was really done by the two authors I've just mentioned, and it then has been developed a little bit further by some people on my team for the macro level. So let's look for the micro level. That's the level of implementation of a policy. And here it was seen that there was a disconnect between the practitioners who were supposed to do the gender mainstreaming, and the way they talked about it, and the way they talked about it was the official accepted European talk about gender mainstreaming, but that was in disconnect to their own experience in the workplace, where they had a different idea about the place of women and men in the workplace there. And their understanding was then just basically on very direct discrimination of a woman, but not concerning the underlying structural ways of making sure that women have less access to better jobs in the public enterprises. The gender knowledge can be differentiated, and one could say there is perhaps a collective one, and the collectives can of course be different types of collectives, a very big one, a smaller one, and so on. And here it is what a group of people, and that's kind of from the science of knowledge, a group of people kind of share as beliefs, and then we also have individual ones, which can then differ, of course, from the collective ones. A further differentiation you can do is the practice, the everyday knowledge, how it's really being performed, the way you deal with the other, with the woman or the man, then the institutionally produced knowledge, which is usually more consistent, comes out of academia or from religious organizations or other places. And there is a popular knowledge that comes perhaps through journalist articles or within certain associations there. So that one can see that there is not one gender knowledge, there are different types of knowledges, and one has to look at that carefully. When we move from the micro level, where we have then seen how practitioners perhaps then talk about gender mainstreaming but act differently, we could also go to the macro level and see how gender knowledge is actually influencing theory building. And for the labor market, of course, economists are very important, and mainstream economics claim to be gender neutral, most of them. But when one looks closely, and feminist economics have shown that in great detail, it assumes the rational man and does neglect the other side of human beings, meaning care responsibilities. And they are usually not concerned about inner household differences. They take the household as given, or if it is Gary Becker, then they assume a very traditional relations between men and women in the household there. Applied to agriculture, agricultural economists, then the recommendations are the input intensification and the commercialization. My two examples have shown that the input intensification, like the tractors, might not really help women, or that the commercialization, if it's commercialized, then men move into this type of business. So their recommendations are not gender sensitive. In a way, their recommendations are neglecting the other side of human abilities. How can one understand the power of these economics? And I think the concept of boundary work helps here. They try to draw boundaries to other types of knowledge, and they impose a hierarchy of knowledge there, where abstract and theoretical knowledge is valued, while context-specific case studies are devalued, or where hard quantitative work is valued, and the soft qualitative work, which really looks at what happens on the ground, then is devalued. And with that, they also construct who is actually allowed to talk in the policy arena and who is not allowed to talk. Now, we see that there is this economics discourse, which is not gender sensitive, and there is the gender mainstreaming. And how does it actually then come together? And it looks to me that there are two ways. There is, in a way, the neoliberal one, where then, in a way, a compromise is found. Women are seen basically then as entrepreneurs. And that's this example of the indigenous vegetables. Here, women should become entrepreneurs, and the other side of what they have to do is overlooked there. Or we have a patriarchal welfare idea, where then the concerns of women are an added concern. So you have commercialization, you have mechanization and so on, but you then also give a little bit more support to the women who do the care work. But you are not questioning the patriarchal gender relations. So that's in a way how then the two come together. This official gender mainstreaming discourse, gender empowered discourse, with the other type of knowledge. So to finalize it, gender knowledge approach calls for an analysis of the meaning making of gender relations in the theories, in the policy communities, practitioners, and of course also then in the rural communities or workplaces or wherever people are working. And I believe if one adopts this kind of a view, one has a better understanding of the policy outcomes, why the policy outcome might be different from its intention, but perhaps one can also use it to actually come up with better policies. Thank you for listening.
A new rule, which is that at 10 I will let you know. At 12.
Actually, it's titled the labor, the story of labor, and the new forms of collectives in Kerala. This is the real story. It's really started as an advocacy piece of specific unions, independent unions, which wanted to. Sort of see how to go ahead in terms of negotiating at various levels. And what I've done is that I've taken three or four different kind of struggles of women workers and bring out informality in different kind of processes. So I've taken one is that there is a new union that has got formed in North Kerala. It's an urban retail sector from shops and establishments, women workers, and then it's linked with the women's movement of and women's struggles of that region. So that's a new kind of way the union emerged in that area. Initially it was Penkootam, and then it became an unorganized women workers association, and which is the second union which has got registered apart from the Kerala has a very strong trade union and working class movement there. And so this is independent of political organizations or political parties, a new sort of women's union that got registered. And there is also another, the Seva Women's Union, that is the first union which got registered apart from the traditional one, the Seva Women's Union, which is there, which is part of the larger Seva, but in Kerala it has a very different specific kind of context. The third is the It's called Supply Co. These are ongoing struggles in which I have sort of documented and interviewed the women who are part of that and the women workers. And the Supply Co is the civil supplies establishments which are there, which is part of the state and which sort of give essential commodities at very low prices. And where there are these women who do packaging, the struggles over there. And then the fourth is the nurses' struggle, which is ongoing. So these sort of different kind of struggles bring out different processes and contexts of relationship between labor, the state and capital, and also the processes of informalization which takes place and how actually women's lives, the informalization, how it's parallel to what their life, the trajectory their lives are taking. It tells something about development, it tells you, the stories tell you something about the nature of democracy in that particular region. And I have of course put it in a larger context. One is that in my paper which is there in the booklet, is the how from the 1980s with liberalization and globalization, how the labor movement has developed, and there's been a big shift in terms of engagement with the state and engagement with the capital, with the state withdrawing all the protective legislation and even eroding existing labor rights. And that is another thing, a section of my paper deals with that, and also how the new forms of organizations, regional level, as well as shop floor levels, all India patterns which are sort of emerging in terms of quite different from the organized industrial working class, the new forms of organizing, the varied kind of coalitions, and the latest when you had the Bharat Bandh and all, you see that how different, not only just trade unions, but movements are also coming into the labor struggles that are taking place. And so I put that in a larger, these Kerala struggles in a larger context, because some of the dialogues are impacting those struggles also. The second part is specifically my papers focusing on Kerala itself, because Kerala since the 1960s onwards, the whole question of the land reforms which took place and land redistribution has an impact, and then also all the labor legislations, the protective labor legislation, the processes of collective bargaining, the institutions which were set up, these all have impacted the way labor, relationship between labor and the state which takes place. And also third, the other part of it is how there has been, since the 1970s, 80s, 90s, Kerala, different governments have enacted various labor funds and labor boards, institutions, where labor boards are there of for particular, say for, there are even for clerks who work in the legal system, there are for the head load workers, so there are whole range of labor funds and labor welfare measures. But there's a whole large section which are still outside it, which is the informal, and a large part of it is the women who are there. And in Kerala, I think what I've located these struggles and this kind of the institutionalization of labor, even the unions, the traditional unions have become institutionalized entities, and they have their own life. And therefore, when they have become, since the 80s and 90s, these have taken place, they become institutionalized political entities. And so a large section of, and on the other hand, there are all these new forms of struggles which are emerging. And there's a big shift. In some earlier studies also which I have done on Kuttanadu, I was looking at what's happening to agricultural labor and the new forms of organization. What is taking place is that there's been a big shift in the politics of labor in Kerala. And from the 90s onwards, particularly with the decentralization process and the people's planning campaign onwards, there's a shift from that focus on the labor, the worker, to that of citizenship. So that is a big shift politically into citizenship, and then there are all these kind of institutions and organizations, particularly like Kudumbashri and different kind of self-governing institutions which have been set up. So labor in that sense, women's work actually, how do you locate it in these different kind of developments which are taking place? So in the piece that we are doing in terms of discussions with the unions, advocacy, what is the level at which you pitch the advocacy, what is the level and what is the kind of different modes of negotiations that you have to take place. Now, one of the things that came across in terms of the challenges was that these unions, the independent unions have formed, they have different constituencies. They also formed in different contexts. And they, like Seva Union, for instance, are very much part of a larger All India, the Seva Gujarat, as well as the larger in terms of self-help groups and engaging within the system to make certain changes. Kankutam, for instance, and the women's group which is there in North Kerala have just conducted struggles. And they have not been able to get the support of the major unions, in the sense that in the negotiation, the major unions have put a condition that you become members of the union and then you become. So there is this whole thing about having, you be an autonomous organization, how do you build alliances in that, and how do you negotiate with the state, where there is a very large, established, institutionalized, working class trade union movement and organization. So I think that is what I've taken the paper, I cannot give all that. I've taken a lot of these case studies to show some of these processes and why it's very, how it sort of brings out different facets that you cannot only take the site of work as the point of engagement. So therefore now there is a whole shift which has been taking place in all the unorganized sector struggles, is now you are not individually engaging with a particular employer, engaging with the state now, and in terms of your livelihood issues altogether. It's not just only minimum wages or your work contracts. It's about overall your life conditions and livelihood conditions. So there's a whole shift to citizenship, which is there, which is taking place, and therefore how do you sort of engage when you have a local governance which is which has an enabling environment in Kerala. So within that, how do you put across these issues? So one of the things that in the discussion that is emerged is that to the Kurumbashri, for instance, is actually the focus is on Kurumbashri as an enterprise. So that has to be, there has to be an input within that in terms of looking at labor. So the whole perception of Kurumbashri who work and who are doing livelihood activities is not of an enterprise, not of them being a particular identity as worker. So that is something that needs to be put in, and how do you bring that into local governments? Do you have a register of workers that you know, of women? They may not be working shop. Those who work in the shops may not work at a particular period, and they get laid off after every 2-3 years. They get laid off. So then, where do you account for them? The unions don't account, and there's a difference between the traditional unions and these new organizations is that traditional unions, you have to be a worker employed. If you are sort of dropping out, then you're not part of, you're out of work, you're not part of these unions at that particular time. So these unions, in fact, the independent unions have that kind of flexibility, and that's a negotiation which is going on with the trade union, that we are also workers, or we may be out of work for a particular period, we may be laid out, but we have to be members of that union. Or we have our own independent unions and we come together. And the other part is in terms of the whole thing about the urban retail sector. It brings out stories of urbanization. How Calicut is very interesting, because you find that these stories of the labor, they originally actually were, they come now from the peripheries of the city, to the shops which are sort of being set up with all the Gulf return money and a new commodity kind of commodification that is taking place in terms of selling varied kind of big malls and shopping malls, and these women are coming from the peripheries. But when you see the story, they were actually at the center of Calicut. And they have lost land, they have built their houses, and they without any. So there has been a process of kind of dispossession which is taking place in that. Urbanization process. So it tells stories of the nature of a particular region and the urbanization, and therefore the corporation which has self-governance, how does it plan urban development programs? It also has got to do with public works. Do public works, the design of public works, do they cater to women, say women, how, if they are going to work, child care facilities, as well as, can public works be directed at this, which has been done in many countries, South Africa, they've done public works, the employment, like our employment guarantee scheme, they've got public works which is designed to child care and various old people's care. So these are very interesting stories, bring out different kind of processes which are involved in informality, in terms of even the design of public works. And this is something that you can intervene in the context of Kerala. You can intervene and say that this is the way that a certain public design of a program can be designed, because the local governance has a say in designing the employment programs. So the story is, there is a positive and enabling environment as well as this is a story.
Thank you.
I was given this
subject of measurement of pale wallpaper, right? But that doesn't really reflect the contours of pale wallpaper. That's why I've changed the title and made it integrating pale wallpaper relevant to the theme of the of this thing. Now, this so this paper basically discusses concept of paid and unpaid work, present challenges faced by policymakers in addressing paid and unpaid work, present strategies that help in addressing the challenges, and the final answer is what is needed is expanding horizons of microeconomics. Now, as we all know, those who have read the document of UNSNA, they know it very well that the total economy is built of four or five things. One is financial corporations and private units, non-financial corporations and private units, government sector, voluntary sector, and household. This is the total economy, and so all productive, nothing unproductive about it. Now, these have been divided into production boundary, that is macroeconomics, and the rest of it. Now, this macroeconomics has been defined in a manner that it includes all production of goods, either for pay or profit or for barter or for sale. Non-market products which are included in this are mainly agriculture, which is very widely this thing, then goods produced in any other manner than households, for example. But household services and non-voluntary services are outside. That means production done within the household is included in macroeconomics and national income accounts and all that. But services are not there. And the argument made is why are unpaid services out of microeconomics? Because it consists of total economy and only unpaid services are taken out. The reasons they give are very simple. They say first of all that unpaid services do not impact on macroeconomics. But we know it's not true at all, because when unpaid work is performed, it reflects in human capital formation, it reflects in the market performance of women and so on and so forth. So that argument is not correct. The second argument made is that if you include unpaid work, it will stamp away the entire economy towards this. But that also we don't accept. Because stamp away means what? I mean, you are talking in terms of male bias, and this doesn't really take care of women's work. So that argument is not acceptable. And third is that if we say include unpaid services in the macroeconomics, then unpaid services means everybody is employed. So it's full employment, and the concept, traditional conventional concept of employment will not be valid, will not be relevant. But so what? It means that you have to think in terms of alternative policy tools, alternative concepts, and alternative economics. So we don't accept this argument. For example, let me give you an case. When agriculture production is done in the field, it's produced, it's processed, it's stored, and it comes to the home. And then it is cooked, and processed, and then cooked. And then it is eaten. Only the eating part is consumption, rest of it is production. Because production means what? Addition to the utility. But no. We don't accept that. We said that till when it comes to home, it's not in macroeconomics. This is something what not true at all. Cooking is definitely a part of production and has to be in macroeconomics. Similarly, when the child is born, child is taken care of, health, education, capital formation of the child, that is in unpaid work. But when the child enters into school, then it enters macroeconomics. Now, this is really not acceptable at all. So what is happening in reality is that it's a male bias which determines the demarcation line which is of course arbitrary line, as they also accept it. This arbitrary line demarcates and gives male bias to macroeconomy. It makes women's work, which is productive, invisible, and it makes it unimportant, and it's not covered in macroeconomic policies. So the work is invisible, not considered, and not considered by macroeconomic policies also. Now this is something really very unfair, and this is something which we do not have to accept. Now why do we worry about unpaid work? What are the main reasons for that? I think the main reason why we worry about unpaid work is that unpaid care is a very critical thing for any economy. Your care of children, care of disabled, care of old, this is something which is a part of human rights. It's a major input for well-being of people. And that's why care is important. And out of this care, 80% of care is taken care of within the household, which is unpaid. Well, this is not proper at all. Because care, which is economic, because paid and unpaid work are interrelated, and you take out some care, and when it comes here, you take in, again you took out, that is not done. And that's why care has to be there as a part of macroeconomics, because it contributes to well-being, it contributes to human capital formation, it contributes to rejuvenation of labor when it comes back. Because when a worker comes home in the evening, he is taken care of, he sleeps, he gets food, everything, and then goes home next day. This is nothing else but taking care of depreciation of labor. Now that, if depreciation of capital is in macroeconomics, why is there depreciation of labor? And that's why, you know, the whole macroeconomy, the concept of macroeconomics is something which is biased and which is not acceptable. Secondly, you know, what happens is that it's not good. Care, unpaid care is important for social and economic sustainability. Production, reproduction, they go to market, labor market, they work, another generation is produced. This is part of economics. It sustains the economy, it sustains the society, and that's why it's important. You can't neglect it. Thirdly, women's predominance in this work is extremely unjust. That's why we worry about it. Because 80% of work, unpaid services, are done by women at the global level. I'm talking about the average. And if that is the case, women, what is the gaining process? Invisibility, and not included in macroeconomics, and not considered at all important for public policy. And that's why this is unjust, this is unfair, this is human rights violation, because it means that you don't get equal right to women, and that's why it is extremely important to worry about by any society, because this is something we should not be allowed. Again, it's huge loss to microeconomics. First of all, why? Because human capital depletion takes place. When a woman goes to the labor market, she does paid and unpaid work both, her human capital gets depleted, and that's because even malnutrition of women, which is a general thing observed in many developing countries, is nothing done with human capital depreciation. And that human capital depletion, which means human capital stock in the economy is declining, and this is a major macroeconomic loss. Another thing is that sex-based division. How do you know that women are not good enough as a doctor or engineer or any other office work or anything like that? Women are doing this work. Why? Because they are women. This is unjust, it's a social construct, and this is something which is not good for human capital formation for the economy, because it means that the total labor force in the economy is suboptimally used. You are not making optimum use of the labor force that's paid and unpaid labor available to the economy, and that's why it's a big loss. Again, when women enter the labor market, they carry unpaid work on their shoulder. They also have low human capital because they don't get enough education, health, etc. And There are also social norms along with that. And that's why what happens is that the performance of women in labor market is very poor. First of all, they don't go. And if they go, then the performance is very low. Low participation rate, low higher unemployment rate, low wages, segregation, discrimination. And that's why what happens to women is that labor market is lost. And this is again suboptimal use of labor force. And that's why this is something which should not be allowed. And if you think in terms of future human capital formation for macroeconomics, if you think in terms of optimum use of labor, if you think in terms of justice to women, if you think in terms of overall economic development, then women should be introduced equally in the labor market. So it is not a gender issue. It's a macroeconomic issue. And that we must remember, that it is not a gender issue, it's a macroeconomic issue. Now, what do we do about it? Now, that means that what is our goal, first of all? Let us decide. What do we want? We want rebalancing of labor. We want good people to go for more efficient work, and less educated, less qualified people, or less productivity people should go for low productivity. That's with the optimal use of labor. You know, you must remember one thing, that unpaid labor is a lagging sector. Because unpaid workers, what is unpaid workers' problem? You know, they, first of all, it's a routine job, it's a monotonous job, it's a 24-hour job, there is no retirement, there is no upward mobility, there is no benefit of any kind, and no exposure to outside world. That means you don't get acquired knowledge from outside. And that's why unpaid work by itself is a lagging sector in the economy. It's not even taken care of by macroeconomic policies, so their productivity, their knowledge, their conditions are not taken care of by macroeconomic policies. And that's why this is a lagging, useless kind of a sector from macroeconomic point of view. Of course, it does something very important for, but that kind of a thing, very lagging sector is there, then we have to rebalance in a manner that the lagging sector is reduced and lagging sector performs in an optimal fashion with another thing. That means you have to provide equal opportunities to all. Social-political equality, it should establish our rebalancing. And optimal use of labor force in workforce should take place, and human capital formation should take place in a manner so that everybody gets right. Now, how do we do that? That's my last point, and I don't want to. Sorry. How do we do this? I think, first of all, I think there is something around here.
Thank you.
No, forget about it, then I'll talk from my DC notes. How do we do this? First of all, we need valuation of unpaid work. Valuation of unpaid work means that you value the unpaid death services in monetary terms and show that women have contributed so much, and that's why women have a claim on public exchequer. So this is something which helps. But that's all, nothing more than that. Second thing what we can do is that we reduce unpaid work, the lagging part of it, drudgery part of it, and recognize it, of course, by time to survey, reduce it and redistribute it. That means some part we take it to the mainstream, like child care. So have public services, public child care, universal child care, so that service moves to the macroeconomy. And there are many like that, water to the doorstep. That means you are taking the water responsibility to the mainstream economy. So some part you take to the mainstream economy, some part you reduce, some part you improve technology. For example, cooking. If you give them some good fuel, then they'll be able to use it and they'll be able to have less time left on it, less drudgery will decline. So recognize, reduce, and reorganize. But what is more important is sharing. women and men should share this work, because all work cannot be given to macroeconomics, macroeconomy, or cannot be transferred to mainstream economy. Some work we have to make, which makes family a family. And that work has to be shared equally. So that is something very important. That is the second strategy that we use. Second strategy as this. The third strategy, which is very important, is that we use certain development policies which are important for the economy, like employment policy. We have employment policy in a manner that labor market, when women enter, they get social security, they get maternity benefit, they get all everything, but not in a manner that women's duty for home-based services is reconfirmed. We want that to be shared by men, even in the workplace. So the rule that if there are 20 women, you should have a child care center is absolutely irrelevant. Whenever there are men or women working, you have to have a child care center. So these are the kind of things, so you provide that. Second is, for women's entry into the labor market, you have to provide them education, skill, and other things so that they can compete, and not proper to proper kind of a thing, but non-traditional, modern skills, so that they can enter into the labor market with equal footing, and that's something which is important. So one is employment policy. Second is social protection. Social protection not only as worker in the labor market, but also at home, they should get social protection, because after the certain time they have worked, they get some kind of a benefit on that, sharing, or they get or some kind of allowance from the government. Many countries are giving this allowance. Third is overtime. Okay, fine. So, one sentence and I start. Third is care policies, migration policies, but one sentence which I would like to say that ultimately paid and unpaid work are part of macroeconomics, and if you want this to be integrated in the macroeconomic, paid and unpaid should be integrated, then we have to think in terms of new macroeconomics, which is of course being worked by people. People are already working on this, but that is the solution ultimate.
Thank you.
Don't allow questions. I've been told that we can have questions, but I'm going to only have two questions. All the papers, in some way, they were linked to each other. I would urge you to raise not individual questions. That can be done over tea. Students to ask.
There also that thing should be added, it was totally ignored. So should that national income accounting system be revamped accordingly, in together with valuation of that work?
Ma'am, your presentation was excellent. Your final conclusion saying that we need to look out for a new macroeconomics. If you have thought about it, and if you have certain indicators, what would it comprise of? If you can throw some light on it, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Both, if they want. That is, the original a person to whom it was addressed, but others can also. And that
will
be, yeah, okay.
I think if we value unpaid work, GDP will go up, obviously. Yeah. But GDP will go up for all the countries, because you can't have only one country and compare it with other countries where it is not included. So GDP has to be included in all the countries. And it is not happening right now, and that is why right now what is happening is that unpaid work is valued in satellite accounts. Satellite accounts is accounts outside the mainstream main accounts. And if you, the ultimate idea about satellite accounts is that only it will be possible for satellite accounts to be incorporated in the mainstream economy. So that's why we keep it separate right now. When everybody does, maybe we'll have that. The macroeconomics, now it's a very big question, I can't answer that question right now, but I'll just say one thing. That if there is a macroeconomic policy, like, you know, social, your prices of health goes up, health services go up. This is a macroeconomic, because right now privatization is happening under globalization. So privatization means health prices go up. When health prices go up, what happens? When there is a there will be a large number of families which will try to get their care service within the family. If somebody goes, becomes sick, don't go right now, we'll see later on. And whose burden increases in the process? Whose burden? So, similarly, when we get this crisis, who suffers? Women. Because when the man is unemployed, income is less, women have to do a lot of work in their home to cook, to help, to take care of services. Children go to cheaper school and so on and so forth. So, burden falls on women. And that's what it means. The entire concept is much different, yet even different later on.
Thank you. Anyone else want to
I just want to, on the macroeconomics issue, the alternate, yeah, we want an alternate world, we want an alternate methodologies, we want alternate economics, certainly we want another world and not what we have right now. Now, within this, I just on the macroeconomic component, I want to extend it beyond what is social protection and employment, etc. Your fiscal architecture, your monetary policies, which are there, just to give you one example of the way finance policies are operating is drink and how it impacts unpaid labor is a national rural drinking water policy, which is supposed to develop drinking water and reduce women's burden in terms of walking for 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, etc. Allocations from the national rural development drinking water scheme have been transferred. Huge allocations have been transferred to our great Swachh Bharat. Okay. Now one is the disconnect between water and sanitation, and the other is one at the cost of the other. So in fact your fiscal architecture now is increasing women's unpaid work. That is one very important component. Secondly, the issue of children, I just want to say that please let's not see them as children. They are children, which is a different issue. They are the future workforce. And women and girl children have equal rights to be part of the future workforce as men and boy children do. So therefore, and that links up to various UN covenants, etc., etc., is to perceive. So if it is a future workforce, the state has a definite responsibility and not only the family. Many more, but yeah. I think we can do
that.
No, I just want to make a point that to think about alternatives is really important to bring these dialogues both into the state in terms of engaging with the state as well as to those who are organizing, those who are struggling, into the unions, into different kind of alliances that are getting built. To bring these conversations into that is critical to building alternatives.
Absolutely.
The macroeconomic debate has shown that there is a specific gender knowledge of neglect, and what Professor Irvai has pointed out as an alternative also means a completely different gender knowledge. If she is talking about sharing the unpaid work, it means a complete change in how women and men should behave in the household. So I think that's a nice example of very different types of gender knowledges.
Thank you very much. And
please remember, you started your first session late, so obviously it's going to snow over, and there's no way you can stop that. And I will take my 2 minutes because I haven't come for nothing, so I should also say a couple of things. So I want to, and as a historian, I want this generation to understand that the vote did not come without incredible amounts of violence. That there was terrific violence against the women. I don't know if you've read this, because nobody reads history. Nobody reads history because we are the great Bharat, or unless of course, can't be our policy. So who wants to read history anyway? It's been written out of history. But the fact is, women chained themselves to the banisters in front of the Parliament House in London, and the amount of vitriol they got from men, the reaction from men, from democratic men, was incredible. So I want you to remember that when we think and we celebrate whatever 100 years of freedom, let us also see what that freedom came as, and this generation which got the freedom to vote, please use it judiciously also, from my point of view. I want to also think about, you know, why we, how come that the historians are actually, and especially current day popular perception, are not actually interested in talking about women as economic agents. They only talk, they're basically, you know, women are in the family, we have this great philosophy and families all that they are interested in. So we had Gargi and Maitri, the world was fantastic, we don't need anything else. And nobody needs to look at the economy, nobody needs to look at what women did. But let's look at the economy. Women were always stratified, women always worked. And I want to just tell you a little story about a woman whose mistress had a great reputation. A woman has this great reputation for being a perfect worker, perfect housewife. She does everything perfectly. And one day this woman who's called Kali, she says, now, is my mistress really such a good worker, or is it because I do my work so well that she has this reputation of being a such a great worker? So she decides to test the mistress. So she gets up late every morning for 3 successive mornings. She is supposed to have a great temper, wonderful temper. First day, she says, hey, what's with you, why are you late? Next day, she says, what's wrong with you? And the third day, she takes the kunda and bangs the worker, Kali, on her forehead, and she has blood splattering on her. She takes that, and there's a punchline to the story. She goes all around the marketplace and she says, my mistress hit me. She doesn't have such a great temper. Okay? So the temper, the goodness of this woman is... So she actually announces to the world the perception of exploitation. There is a perception of exploitation that people observe, all of the work that they did. So I think that it's important for us to recognize that women are stratified, women have worked always, all women have worked, and some women have also tried to shift the burden of their work onto others, and that makes for domestic labor completely in being invisibilized in certain ways. So it's the poster that the women's movement made early on, there's a famous poster of which CiRiC had made, you know, of the goddess with many arms, the controversial one. They said, okay, why did we have these? Yeah, so this, you know, there's this woman with so many arms. The Women's Movement workshop actually turned this around. And so you created this this goddess, but she had more than many armed goddess. It's a counter to the story that we, you know, you go home, in television we used to see this ad, a man comes home and he enters the door and the woman's waiting to tell him something and she says, ye hua, and he says, mujhse mat kaho, main bahut thaka hua hoon, maine bahut kaam kiya hai. As if to say, wo aurat jo ghar mein baithi hai na, usne kuch nahi kiya. Sara din baithi hai, TV dekh rahi thi shayad. So, you know, this is the attitude. So, mere ghar mein kaam nahi karti is the formula that they work on. So these women in the workshop created many little loops like that, you know, all over, you know, kura dalna, ye karna, wo karna, you know, chara dalna and all. And then at the bottom they have this, what's it called, you know, the lower part, and she says, bacha janne ka dabba. So, you know, that is reproduction function. And they put the reproductive function. So these unlettered women, quote unquote, actually got a complete understanding of the exploitation of women's labor, and which nobody paid any attention to. So it's great that this conference is happening and that people are debating it, and I hope we're going to have many more of these sessions. Thank you very much.